Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadra, the Director of Portfolio Management at Tricom. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, Tricom was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Kim Gerbeau with Assurance. Kim is a senior compliance advocate on the Assurance Risk Services team. She specializes in creating highly personalized relationships with clients to help them navigate through their compliance concerns. Kim is passionate about employment law matters and focuses on assisting employers with the numerous compliance challenges they face, including leave management, FMLA, non-discrimination issues, and ADA accommodations. In addition to her focus on the employment law, she also has extensive background in employee benefits, legislative and regulatory issues, including HIPAA, cafeteria plans, HSAs, the ACA, and more. She translates legislative jargon into easily digestible, need-to-know information so her clients can avoid penalties and design optimal benefit strategies. Before joining Assurance, Kim was a benefit analyst at a benefits administration firm where she assisted employers and employees with benefits enrollment, compliance issues, payroll, and more. Kim graduated from Calvin College with a bachelor's degree in sociology and minors in social work and urban studies. Assurance, a Marshall and McLennan Agency, LLC company, is a full service brokerage providing business insurance, employee benefits, private client insurance, and retirement services to business and individuals across the country. Assurance operates as the agency's Midwest regional headquarter, consistently recognized as a top workplace. Assurance attracts and retains insurance talent by rewarding expertise, investing in career development, and recognizing contributions. Assurance colleagues enjoy an award-winning culture that fosters a highly productive and results-driven working environment. Employers are addressing new COVID-19 employment issues related to return to work policies, workplace safety, and vaccinations. In today's Industry Insider webinar, Kim with Assurance will be providing employers with a better understanding of the current return to work landscape, including what they can ask about vaccination status, implementing employee policies within the workplace, and other COVID-related issues employers may be facing. We'll cover how to work with employees expressing concern around return to work and what potential concerns employers should be on the lookout for. By the end of the session, employers will have a better understanding of how to manage the return to work employment issues. If you have any questions during the presentation, please go ahead and use the chat or Q&A feature, and we will cover all questions at the end. With that, I will turn the floor over to Kim.
Great. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much. I am very happy to be here. The first thing we'll be talking about when we're discussing COVID employment issues and returning to work is what the DOL has to say and what they are currently looking at when determining return to work conditions and specifically unemployment, because that is a huge area of concern for employers when they're trying to get employees back at work and developing their programs. Under the expansion of the Pandemic Unemployment Assistance Program, this allows laid off workers to receive unemployment benefits that they may not otherwise be eligible for under state law if they refuse to return to work if there's certain conditions at play. So that said, an employee just can't refuse to return to work and automatically qualify for unemployment. We'll touch on that a little bit later. But what the DOL has said under the PUA, if an employee is asked to return to work and they feel as though the job site is unsafe, specifically because it is not in compliance with local, state, or national health and safety standards. They may qualify for a separate unemployment benefit that, again, they might not otherwise be eligible for under state unemployment laws. This is a change from the stance previously taken by those state unemployment agencies. So things like mask wearing, physical distancing, and any other protective equipment provisions consistent with the public health guidelines at any given time are to be considered. Again, when you're putting together your return to work program, you want to make sure that you are following those local and national ordinances and mandates to make sure that you're in compliance with them to avoid employees being able to go file for this type of unemployment. On a state level, some things that, on the state level, some things that you do want to consider is evaluating your employees in the positions that they're in. If they're able to continue to work remotely, it is encouraged that you allow them to do so at this point. Again, we clearly understand that's not possible for all niches within different industries. But if you do have employees that can work remotely and you're able to allow them to, it is encouraged to continue that. Also ensuring appropriate social distancing and face covering practices based on current guidance. Again, as I'm sure everybody's seen, that is all over the place right now, varying by state to state. So just really making sure you're staying abreast of what the current guidelines are in each location's area. For employers with multiple locations across the country, it is important that each location is remaining in compliance with their local ordinances. Employers who do have face covering requirements should make sure that they also have those available at no charge to employees who may need them. Obviously, you can encourage your employees to bring their own, make sure it's something that they're comfortable in that meet any specifications that you may have, but in the event an employee shows up without a mask or some sort of face covering, making sure that you do have one available to them is important. Also, reviewing any communal spaces to confirm social distancing requirements can be met, or if they can't be, to make sure that policies are implemented to, again, maintain that safety factor. And also requiring visitors to follow any health and safety requirements that are in place both under federal and state law, as well as that you've implemented within your workplace. So if you're requiring everyone to continue to wear a face covering, you would want to also make sure that visitors are aware that they will be expected to wear a face covering when they visit your location. You also want to make sure that all employees have been trained on applicable safety protocols. You want to really make sure that your employees are aware of what the safety standards are, what they should be doing, and make that very clear. That also helps employees feel more comfortable returning to the worksite or staying at the worksite if they've been back, just knowing what the current safety protocols are at any given time. I've also been asked frequently, can we require our employees to return to work? A lot of employers have found that they have certain employees that are just refusing to return to work. And the short answer is yes, employers can absolutely require their employees to return to work. At the same time, an employee may refuse to return to work. That said, if an employee refuses to return to work, they may not qualify for unemployment. If you have designed your return to work strategy in a way that you are meeting all of those safety measures and precautions in accordance with federal and state law, it's likely that the employee may not qualify for unemployment. Many businesses do need their employees back in order to operate at their normal capacity. So it is 100% acceptable to tell employees that they do need to return to work. Again, if they do refuse, they may not be eligible for those unemployment benefits. That's not 100% the case. Always keep in mind that when an employee files for unemployment benefits, there are various factors taken into consideration when determining their eligibility, but solely based on the refusal to return to work due to a fear of contracting COVID or whatever the case might be, does not automatically grant them the ability to receive unemployment benefits. And again, things that are taken into consideration are just the health and safety, morals, physical fitness, prior training, et cetera. If an employee refuses to turn to work, a question I get asked a lot is, do they have job protections of any kind? And the answer again is generally no. Employees may use some sort of vacation time that they have saved up or other sort of PTO that you might have in place. Some state and local governments have implemented certain protections or time off. So you again want to make sure that based on the location where a certain employee might work, that you are following any state and local ordinances and requirements. But generally, there are no job protections for an employee who's just refusing to return to work. Again, if the employee feels as though they're in some sort of an imminent danger under OSHA or feels as though they're otherwise being discriminated against, there may be protections in very certain scenarios. If the employee genuinely feels as though there is a danger that a reasonable person would agree to, or maybe that it's not a safe work location, that there are mask violations, lack of complying with safety requirements. At that point, they may have some level of protections, but assuming that as an employer, you again have put in place a return to work policy and safety procedures that meet all the safety guidelines, there's generally no job protections. And again, you also want to make sure that you're treating all employees generally the same. If an employee comes to you and just says, I don't want to return to work, I'm not comfortable, and leaves it at that with no accommodation needs, we'll get into that as well in a few minutes. They generally would not have any job protections, but again, you want to make sure that any employee that comes to you with that same stance, you're treating the same way. There are whistleblower concerns that employers should also be aware of that can lead to discrimination claims, even in times where employers might be wanting to help employees out. I've been asked if, you know, when developing a return to work program, I've had employers ask me if they could proactively provide accommodations to a certain subset of employees that might, to their understanding, fall under some sort of a ADA accommodation, religious exemption, whatever the case might be. Basically class out a certain type of employees that they think will need an accommodation. And while, again, the mindset is certainly in a genuine place trying to help those employees out, it can actually backfire and become a discrimination claim. So when you're looking at potential accommodations, you certainly want to wait for employees to come to you and request them before automatically granting them. I had an employer ask if they could just allow all employees that are of a certain age, older population, whatever the case might be, if they could allow them to work from home or continue to work remotely, but require all of the younger employees to continue to come into work or come back to work. And again, that's an assumption that somebody needs an accommodation they might not want, and they could actually feel as though they're being discriminated against based on their age. If an employee, however, does need an ADA accommodation, that is certainly something that employers need to take into consideration. Individuals who are at high risk of a serious health complication if they were to contract COVID may need a reasonable accommodation under the ADA. This does help avoid discrimination claims. However, again, you don't want to assume that an employee needs an accommodation. Rather, you always want to make sure that the employee is aware of if they do need an accommodation that they can come to you and request it, but you want to wait for them to come to you and make that request. What is good is the CDC has kind of listed out conditions that do fall under a serious health condition and increased risk if they were to contract COVID. I won't name all of them, but some of them include things such as cancer, kidney disease, diabetes, neurological conditions, Down syndrome, certain heart conditions, obesity, pregnancy is included on there, strokes. So again, just keeping in mind that there is a list out there. I actually was looking at it the other day. They are continuously kind of tweaking it and updating it and are expanding more on what they mean in some of those, especially when you get into other neurological conditions, et cetera, what exactly they mean. So certainly if somebody comes to you with that request, you'll want to look at kind of what the current stance and guidelines are. As with any request under the ADA, you do want to make sure that they're being assessed on a case-by-case basis, which I do understand can be very overwhelming right now as there has been a huge influx in accommodation requests. But you do still want to make sure that you're treating each one individually and working through that full interactive process under the ADA to come up with an appropriate accommodation for that employee. Again, all of the requests should go through the same process, though, and be treated in a non-discriminatory manner. These evaluation requests would be based on the type of accommodation being requested, job position, potential duration of the request, whether that request would sufficiently mitigate a direct threat, and whether it would create an undue hardship to you as an employer. So again, things that might be considered a reasonable accommodation are things such as teleworking, an alternative work schedule, maybe allowing the employee to come in before or after kind of peak hours and complete their work at that time, or perhaps shorter hours, kind of a part-time position for the time being, that again allows them to not be there during peak hours. Maybe relocating an employee's workstation to a less populated or higher ventilated area. Again, each request should be viewed on an individual basis to really determine what is the appropriate reasonable accommodation for that individual. One question I have been asked a lot is, what if the employee doesn't need an accommodation, but what if they have a family member that's protected under the ADA? Do you have to make an accommodation for the employee due to a family member's medical condition? And the answer is no. The ADA itself only covers the individual with the disability and not the family members. So an employer is not in violation of the ADA for not making an accommodation to an employee who doesn't have the disability or need for an accommodation themselves. That said, in the current landscape, it is encouraged, if you are able to and when possible, to work with employees as much as you can to accommodate them, again, just from an employee relations perspective and keeping talent. You want to try and work with employees as much as you can, again, within a reasonable mindset that you still expect the employee to continue to do their work and meet certain performance standards, that type of thing. Again, if an employee is able to telecommute or work remotely and that has proven effective and they're still getting their work done, maybe that is a reasonable accommodation that you could make, again, even if the employee themselves does not need that accommodation under the ADA. That said, you also want to make sure that that accommodation is expressed very clearly to the employee, that it is not an ADA accommodation officially for the employee. It's just an accommodation you're making for the employee due to a family member's health condition. But again, it's not required. So as they come in, just handling things on a one-off basis. And also keep in mind, like I said, things that you would consider when you're evaluating those requests are things like job position. So if one individual comes and indicates that they need an accommodation under the ADA and their position really does require them to be in the office, the accommodation might be different than somebody who does some sort of data input or something of that nature where they can work remotely. It's been proven effective and they can still work from home and you're able to make the accommodation. Even if they have the same request, their job position might alter the final outcome. One area of concern that has still popped up across the country is an employee refusing to return to the physical location due to childcare issues. I do strongly caution employers from terminating employees solely due to childcare issues, unless you've really vetted that concern out. And again, it varies based on employee situation, area, childcare availability, et cetera. But there have been cases that have started popping up and we haven't seen the outcome of them, which is why I say you definitely want to vet out any concerns before you opt to terminate somebody solely due to a childcare issue. Because we have run into potential discrimination claims, especially if you are allowing employees to work remote. They might still have children in the background making sounds, whatever the case might be. Obviously, you do still want to set certain parameters and work standards, but making sure you're not being discriminatory against parents is really the key there. Even, you know, I'm in the Chicagoland area. Most of the daycares around here are still operating on some level of reduced hours, et cetera. So, you know, really working with an employee to see what is their concern, what sort of problems might they be running into when it comes to childcare before you just terminate them because they say, my children are home and I need to stay home with them. Is it that their daycare's hours are now only 9 to 3 still, but your work hours typically are 7 to 5. And so, you know, from an employee's perspective, they can't come to work at all. Maybe you're able to work something out with the employee. Again, not required, just something to be cautious of when you're looking at some of the things that are popping up with employees and getting them back to work. The other thing that's been asked a lot is what happens if an employee contracts COVID after they return to work? I'm going to point out Illinois laws. Just know that various states have different laws that may or may not be similar. So definitely check your local workers' compensation laws, again, based on where an employee is located. And these do continue to evolve as well. There is a rebuttal presumption, which basically indicates that if an employee contracts COVID at work, the assumption is that they got it at work and the employer would have to actually actively refute that claim in order to have it denied. There are scenarios that are very effective. If the employee has worked from home for the last 2 weeks, they come in one day, the very next day they test positive for COVID. It's very likely that they did not contract it at work. If as the employer, you followed all of the CDC and public health guidelines, and the employee still indicates that they contracted it there, that claim may be denied. Or if you're able to show that they likely were exposed to it somewhere else, you know, maybe you have proof that they were at a concert or some huge party and it's likely they contracted it there, that claim could also be rebutted. But again, just keep in mind that those workers' compensation laws are key to really look at right now when you're developing that return to work policy. I've also been asked, does workers' compensation cover employees who have an adverse reaction to the COVID vaccination? It only applies if you as an employer are requiring a vaccination for an employee to return to work. In that scenario, under Illinois compensation laws, as well as many of the state's workers' comp laws, it may fall under a valid workers' comp claim. But again, that's generally only if you are requiring a vaccination. And again, we'll touch on requiring versus encouraging vaccinations in just a minute. So when we're looking at face coverings, masks, things like that, getting employees back to work, requiring them to come back to work, requiring them to be vaccinated is really the key one right now. The EEOC has said it must be a direct threat if an employee does not be vaccinated to mandate it. also keep in mind that accommodations might need to be made for some employees, even if you are opting to mandate that an employee become vaccinated. However, many employers, and what's generally encouraged, is to not mandate vaccinations, but rather encourage your employees to become vaccinated. A lot of employers have started doing this through education, offering time off for the vaccination. While it is more widely available now, and employees can certainly generally get it fairly easily as opposed to when the vaccination first came out, still offering a couple of days time off if an employee needs to get a vaccination and potentially to work through any side effects of the vaccination that typically occur within the 24 to 48 hours post-vaccination. Some employers have offered small incentives. If you are doing that, I do encourage you to work with some sort of a wellness provider to ensure that the incentives are being offered in accordance with wellness regulations, because an incentive for that does fall under a wellness incentive category. And some have even gone so far as to have an executive example put, the CEO puts out a message about their vaccination, whatever it might be. You do want to make sure that it does not make employees feel as though they will be discriminated against for not being vaccinated, or that they won't be shamed for it. But again, just setting that example. One key thing that has come up in this kind of a hot topic is, what can an employer ask their employees? You can ask if they have received the vaccination, and you are allowed to require proof of vaccination. Now, when you ask for proof, you really just want a copy of the vaccination card. You want to make sure you don't get any additional medical information from the employee, just proof of their vaccination. Some employers haven't even asked for proof. They just kind of go on an honor system, but you do have the right to require proof of vaccination. Things you want to avoid asking, which I know comes up a lot in just general conversation if you're talking about the vaccination, you don't want to ask, how was the vaccination for you? Did you have any side effects? Are there any other medical concerns or conditions that you had going into it? Again, I know that those are things that in general conversation have started popping up a lot when you're just talking to a friend or someone that you might know about the vaccination, but you want to make sure that you are being very specific about what you're asking your employees, because you don't want them to be able to come back and again indicate that any of the information they provide you was used in any sort of a discriminatory manner. The EEOC has indicated that this information is considered medical information and should be stored accordingly in employees' medical files. Additionally, it really should be an HR person or a single representative at a location that knows how to handle medical information that should be collecting this information. Generally speaking, supervisors should really only be told which employees are mask optional. That's a huge term that's being used right now that is strongly recommended. Because that way you're not officially telling anyone's vaccination status. There are various reasons somebody might be mask optional. They might have a religious exemption, a medical condition, whatever the case might be. But it's really best to just let supervisors know, here's the employees that you supervise that are mask optional. The other thing to keep in mind, I know a lot of people really rely on the CDC guidance, but it is important to keep in mind that CDC provides guidance, not regulations. So while you do want to make sure that you're considering CDC guidance and following it, it's really the state and local ordinances or any federal ordinances that you really want to make sure that you are following, because those are the ones that are really making the laws and regulations around what is expected. That said, most of them are falling aligned with the CDC guidance, and it is still strongly encouraged to follow it. But always keep in mind that that's guidance, not regulations. And that said, that's why some employers have opted to maintain fully masked workplaces, and some haven't. Again, just keep in mind that even OSHA has indicated to look at CDC guidance while they review their safety measures on an ongoing basis. So even though CDC is only releasing the guidance, not regulations, most of the others have kind of fallen in line with them and taken their lead on it. The other thing to keep in mind is there are various reasons that employees may want to continue wearing a mask, even if you're not requiring it. And for that reason is why a lot of employers have gone to some level of either strictly following the CDC guidelines or kind of that mask optional idea. So vaccinated individuals don't need to wear it. Vaccinated individuals are encouraged to, but kind of allowing an environment where anyone can wear a mask if they really want to. And that's because some people may be immunocompromised. They might fall into that high risk category. They may have unvaccinated family members. This is especially true of parents returning to work with those with children under the age of 12 who aren't yet eligible for the vaccination. Some people have also decided that they just have liked wearing a mask because it's helped protect them from other things such as cold, flu, et cetera. And so they find that that added level of protection has really been beneficial and they would like to continue doing it. The other thing to consider when you're developing a return to work policy is what your business travel policy will look like. Again, you wanna follow the current FAA guidelines if we're talking about flights. Generally speaking, fully vaccinated travelers aren't required to do any sort of self-quarantining anymore following domestic travel, subject to state and local ordinances. But some other things that we've really started seeing employers consider is the real business necessity of travel and the employee relations associated with it. So getting a feel for your employees, how are they feeling about traveling? Are they comfortable with it? Do they want to get back to it? Some individuals love it. Some might not quite be ready to jump back into traveling yet. And that said, some individuals have been traveling this whole time. So really just taking that into consideration along with that business necessity. With COVID, many employers have actually found that, you know, kind of those telemeetings are very effective. And, you know, maybe merging that and implementing those more than the actual travel is just as effective and more cost effective for the business as well. So really looking at what do you want your travel expectations and policy to be as well. And then when looking at return to work as a whole, you want to consider, are you going to go back to business as usual? Some employers certainly are. Returning to just pre-pandemic with no major changes in your post-pandemic work expectations. And again, in some niches, that's entirely what it needs to be for some industries. However, in other industries, they might find that flexible work options actually help them attract and retain talent more, allowing flexible work schedules, remote work, flex time, maybe allowing employees to change their hours from one week to the next while having kind of a set core hours that they have to work. A compressed work week. I've seen some employers go to allowing employees to work their 40 hours in 4 days. Again, that doesn't work for everybody, but if that is something that would work for you, maybe allowing for that shift work, part-time jobs, maybe allowing job sharing. So again, that all kind of ties together. Maybe two part-time workers could satisfy a full-time position, especially if you run into some of those childcare needs right now. Telecommuting, again, allowing them to work from home. But just really looking at what has happened during COVID, what has worked, what hasn't when it comes to adjustments you may have had to make. And, you know, as you set those return to work expectations, or as you continue to evolve your workplace expectations in the era of COVID, what should those look like? What can those look like for you? When you're looking at developing a return to work plan, or again, assessing your current plan, because as we know, this is kind of an ever-evolving thing, so it's important that you are also always taking a look at your policy to see, do we need to change it? What do we need to do? But first, assess the nature of your business. It is encouraged to do an employee survey, but you only want to do an employee survey if you actually intend on utilizing those results to potentially help drive what your policy will be. Definitely key is developing safety standards and setting office protocols. Are you going to do the physical temp checks? Are you going to do symptom checks? Is it just going to be a, again, kind of an employee honor system? If you have any of these symptoms, don't come to work. Do you want employees to disclose their vaccination status? And then, as I mentioned, most importantly, making sure that you have sent out and provided clear communications to employees to address safety concerns and setting clear expectations. A lot of times, especially for those employees who are hesitant or perhaps scared to return to work, really making sure that you've addressed safety concerns and setting those clear expectations can help put their mind at ease about returning to the workplace. Next, we'll review a few safety considerations. I do want to be mindful of time. And so things that you need to look at, as I mentioned, when you're looking at safety of reopening, CDC guidelines, OSHA guidelines, the current state guidelines. Unfortunately, these are, as I mentioned, continuing to constantly evolve and change, especially on a state level. So it's just really important that you're staying abreast of what's going on within your state that each location is in. Some requirements may differ a little bit, but most are really focusing on the CDC guidance, as is OSHA. And the CDC guidance has generally remained unchanged with regards to vaccinated versus unvaccinated expectations and status. However, as I'm sure we've all started seeing in the news, with certain variants coming out, it's possible that some of that guidance will change. So again, just always making sure you're staying on top of that. But making sure you're really staying on top of, again, the CDC guidance and what your local and state government is saying. I strongly caution employers to avoid just watching the news and going based off of what they say there, but really making sure you're looking at those government websites to determine what your best options are. Another thing that's strongly encouraged is really identifying a workplace coordinator to oversee kind of the COVID prevention efforts. Making sure that there's, you know, a person or a small team of people that is kind of that main contact for employees to go to with concerns, and that helps follow those changes that state and federal recommendations might happen. Just really making sure that there's a core group or person that is following that, and the employees know that they can go to. If it's just kind of haphazard and it's not really specific and determined, it will be very easy for employees who might have concerns to let those concerns go unnoticed. And B, it's possible that you might miss a change in certain local or federal ordinance. You also want to make sure that there's people kind of conducting some of those hazard assessments, and not only prior to bringing employees back, but even, you know, on a routine basis. What tasks or positions might be putting employees the most at risk, and what do you do to help minimize those risks? So again, when you're looking at safety procedures and everything, what positions, those might vary by position. So again, just keeping all of that in mind. You also want to, again, as you're developing those policies, making sure you're establishing social distance practices, providing those flexible work options when you can, creating any physical barriers, signage, virtual meetings when appropriate, just really making sure that you're keeping up with safety and health standards and that you're helping employees feel comfortable with the processes and procedures that you've established. And again, masks, the CDC continues to recommend that unvaccinated people wear masks. Unvaccinated people, they have continued to say don't necessarily need to wear masks. Again, states' guidance have kind of been all over the place, but most businesses are still requiring masks if individuals can't be in their designated seat or can't maintain some level of social distancing. But again, determining what your risk tolerance is and what sort of policy you want to put in place for your specific employees. And again, as I mentioned, that could vary by position. It could be that certain positions, you're more comfortable saying employees have the option to wear a mask, whereas others, you might really say you have to wear a mask if you're in this certain position. You also want to make sure that obviously your cleaning standards are staying up to speed, that frequently touched surfaces are being frequently cleaned, such as workstations, keyboards, doorknobs, handrails, machinery, and that any sort of appropriate PPE and disinfectant is being used as applicable. As I mentioned, you do want to determine what sort of daily health checks are you going to do. Do you want to do them virtual, kind of a self-screening? Some employers have implemented and still continue to utilize some sort of an app or a virtual way for our employees to kind of check in each day. Do you want to do some sort of a health screening in person? Or are you just going to tell your employees kind of, here's our standards, here's what we expect. You're experiencing these symptoms, let us know, don't come into work. Again, just determining how do you want to handle any sort of a daily health check, if at all. Encouraging hand washing often, providing sanitizer throughout the facility, certainly limiting business travel for anyone who's not fully vaccinated. And most employers are still limiting outside visitors as much as possible. Obviously, if you are serving the public, you have quote unquote visitors coming in all the time. So really making sure you're also looking at what can you do to comply with federal and state guidelines, as well as what can you be doing to keep your employees safe and make sure that they feel comfortable with coming into work every day. If somebody has a positive COVID test, the CDC is still recommending the 14-day quarantine. But has still provided some alternative options, such as allowing employees to return to work after 10 days with no test if they also have no symptoms, or potentially allowing them to return to work after 7 days after they've received a negative test result. And again, just really determining what are your guidelines going to be with getting your employees back if they have a positive test. If somebody does have a positive test, employees who were potentially exposed should be made aware, but you also want to make sure that you maintain confidentiality. So for instance, if you have, three different floors of a building and somebody who was on the first floor on a certain date tested positive, just letting any individuals that were in that workspace on that day or days that the employee was likely contagious, that someone, did test positive, you were exposed, and then here's what the expectations are. Officially exposed means that they were within 6 feet of an individual for 10 minutes or more, but most employers are going with a little bit more blanket situation, again, based on industry, to really make sure that they are maintaining employee confidentiality. If somebody has a positive COVID test that has been actively at work in the office or on site, it should be reported to workers' comp as a precaution. It doesn't mean that it's going to end up being a claim or anything of that nature, but the general recommendation is to report it to workers' comp, the workers' comp carrier. Obviously, we strongly encourage people to check with their specific carrier to make sure that they are following how the carrier wants it handled. But as a general statement right now, any positive test should be reported to workers' comp in the event that an employee does file a claim. As I mentioned earlier, states do have those differing laws on whether or not that can become a compensable claim. One area I do want to make sure that we really highlight is this mental well-being as a return to work strategy. You know, the physical areas can clearly be taken care of, through safety protocols and guidelines. But mental well-being is one that has started popping up more and more as employers are getting employees back to work, as, parents are being called back to work, or as, some of these variants that are impacting children more are starting to come out. The mental well-being of employees is certainly one that more and more employers are really trying to take into consideration. During the pandemic, and as we approach kind of a hopefully post-pandemic, almost 4 in 10 adults are suffering from one form of a mental health condition or another, compared to 1 in 10 pre-pandemic. That's a pretty substantial increase. And this has really impacted how those individuals operate and interact in their personal life, but also at work. And a focus on employee mental well-being will really play a key role in any organization's return to work strategy or keeping employees at work. But the good news is there is a lot you can do to kind of help support your employees' mental health. But some things that have really caused some of those mental health stresses are the closure of schools and universities, job loss or lower income, risk of contracting the virus. Communities of color have disproportionately been impacted, and dual roles. A lot of parents are also acting as a full-time worker, a caregiver, a teacher, definitely roles that add that increased stress that they did not have pre-pandemic. What's important to remember as we kind of try and return to the sense of normalcy is that there will be a whole other set of stressors that come along with that, such as, all of a sudden their current routines will be disrupted. Looking for that adequate childcare concerns, even with daycare centers, in areas where daycare centers and daycares are open in full capacity, there are still parents that are quite concerned about sending their children to them. Fear of contracting the virus in the workplace or during the commute to work. These are all areas that, again, have really impacted employees' mental health. So some things to help employees with these things are an open communication channel. Maybe changes in policies or protocols to really, again, inspire confidence and provide clear action steps. And then receiving encouraging feedback and really creating that open dialogue. As I mentioned, just that very clear and concise communication with employees can go a long way in making them feel comfortable coming to work, returning to work, and really help with their mental health as well. If an employee knows and feels like you as an employer are taking their both physical and mental well-being to heart when bringing them back to work and having them there every day, and if they feel like they can come to you with concerns, it's going to improve their mental health. Regular check-ins. Now more than ever, it is strongly encouraged for supervisors or managers to really be routinely checking in with employees to see how they're doing, how things are going. Because again, especially if you start seeing an employee's work maybe suffer a little bit, maybe they're not quite working up to the same standard that they were previously, it might be that something else is going on. So really checking in with them. Education, learning how to name and normalize and navigate some mental health, maybe providing some sort of a webinar, educational training. There's no kind of one size fits all, but really coming up with some mental health tools for your employees, maybe an EAP if you don't have one in place. Maybe even creating some sort of internal support group or allowing employees to create one on their own to kind of provide some resource or encouragement. You also do want to make sure that you have built some resources out for your employees that can help as well. Again, if you have an EAP program, reminding employees that that's out there and what's available in it. If you have mental health benefits through your medical plan, making sure employees are aware that those are out there, that they're an option, that employees can access them. Many carriers now provide some form of telemedicine, MD Live, Teladocs, goes by many names, but just kind of those virtual office visits. Checking with your medical carrier to see what can we offer and let our employees know about, and any potential community resources. And again, when you put this information out there, you do just want to make it very informal but informative, not necessarily encouraging anyone to do anything, not pushing them to any certain provider or resource, but just making them aware of what resources are around and available to them. And then again, looking at those policies and just clearly communicating safety protocols, providing sanitation, visual reminders. These are all things that also help with mental health, in addition to helping make sure that you can clearly point at the fact that you're following applicable safety standards, allowing flexible scheduling when it works for you and your industry. Again, if that's an option, allowing for it. Maybe even providing or promoting more frequent breaks if it won't impact the business too much. Again, just to allow employees to get back in the routine of things. Reviewing leave policies and making sure that you've really clearly laid out what your leave policies are. Some employers are even looking up backup childcare options and programs, to make employees aware of that might be out there. Including elder care support, because some individuals may have also found themselves in a situation where they're also now taking care of elders that they weren't prior to the pandemic. Again, maybe adding some additional mental health programs if you don't currently have them. Many medical carriers or life or disability carriers do have EAP programs that you can tap into. And then perhaps one of the most important things, I think, is training programs for managers. Obviously, you also want to make sure that your manager's mental health is being taken care of, but also making sure that they know how to have difficult conversations with employees. If an employee comes up and lets them know of something going on, a stressor in their life, how they should handle that, how they can have that conversation, how they can respond to it without making that employee feel like they're being stigmatized somehow, and how to really lead that conversation with compassion, and also making sure that managers are educated on laws that they need to be aware of when they are talking to employees about certain things. But really, again, making sure that that communication is clear and that you're making sure your employees' mental health is also being considered when you're implementing and getting them back to work. Because again, even if they've been at work this whole time and you're just reviewing your procedures, as I mentioned, it's now 4 in 10 adults are experiencing some sort of a mental health crisis, whereas it was 1 out of 10 pre-pandemic. So even if they've been at work this whole time, that doesn't mean that there aren't additional mental stressors that have come into play outside of work. And then just looking at promoting employee health and well-being, really talking through with them some emotional building and coping skills and healthy relationships, environmental, financial situations, intellectual activities, being aware that occupation can play a role in mental health. Physicality can play a role. Your social mental health is a huge one right now that has come out because a lot of people did kind of lose some of their social circle or social support system. Spiritual mental health. Again, just making sure that you're really promoting employee health and well-being in a non-discriminatory manner, but making sure your employees know that as you are developing and considering your return to work policy, that you're taking not only their physical health and well-being into consideration, but also their mental health and well-being. And that, again, that they know who they can go to with concerns about either one. So I did leave a few minutes. If there are any questions, I'm happy to address some of those.
Okay, so go ahead and submit any questions that you may have in the chat or Q&A feature. You can also certainly reach out to Kim directly if you had any questions that you'd like to cover offline. Kim, just a quick overview here. What would you say is probably, you know, maybe the biggest question that you would typically get from employers as they're developing their return to work program?
The biggest one that I'm getting right now is what to do about masks or face coverings, just because so much of the information seems to sway a little bit back and forth, because the CDC has indicated, no face coverings for vaccinated individuals are typically required, face coverings for unvaccinated individuals, but then employers are trying to determine how comfortable they are getting information, how much information they want to get. And then again, as these variants are coming out and not knowing how the vaccine will play into them entirely, some employers I've seen that started out with kind of relaxing their face covering policy have kind of re-implemented it. So I really think that, the face covering piece is a huge one, because that's also the one that employees may somehow feel as though is violating their individual rights in some way. So I'd say that that's probably the biggest question I'm getting asked right now. And typically what I recommend is, making sure you're in compliance with your state and federal guidelines. But then again, also just looking at your company culture, your employees, and figuring out what your best determination is based on those factors. Oftentimes indicating that, following the CDC guidelines, but then, like I said, making it kind of mask optional for the vaccinated people and making that kind of a very clear message has kind of gone over the best so far, because it does allow those individuals who are vaccinated but do want to continue to wear masks to wear one without feeling, ostracized or kind of weird within the workplace.
Wonderful. Thank you for covering that. It's definitely, a topic that is top of mind for many employers as they are, looking to implement this return to work strategy. As we're wrapping up today's session, I again just want to thank Kim and all of our attendees for joining us today. But Kim, thank you for sharing your knowledge on the COVID-19 employment issues, return to work, and vaccines. We will have a recording of this session posted on our webinar or on our website in the days to come. And then watch for information on future webinar sessions. We do hold them monthly, so we look forward to seeing you on our next session. And have a wonderful day, everyone. Thank you all for joining.
Thank you.